and very interesting talk about the socio-political context of the law and the political behind the law. You're talking about religion, but the same happens for class. I mean, there's a famous quote, I forget who said it, in the history of the British vagrancy laws, everyone's equal before the law if you sleep under bridges. And of course, only poor people sleep under bridges, rich people don't. So the bias of the law in terms of class, the bias of the law in terms of any differences there. But I'd like to ask you what you think of another fellow who wrote, Michael Mousseau. I think he's either an anthropologist or a sociologist. But he said that the Western society, he didn't talk about secular religious, but he thought about Western, Eastern. And I don't want to fall into Orientalism here, but the idea is that tribal societies are more like community, more homogeneous, more like what Charles Taylor talked about, Catholicism, the Catholic law of community and parish, where you won't have these problems. But Western society is based on social contract where there's pluralism and everything is based on strangers having to recognize each other. And this contract, the law becomes the way that strangers can do business with one another. Whereas in the tribal society, that's not an issue. So no wonder the law is appealing in face of any kind of diversity, any kind of pluralist society. I understand the risks because of the sleeping under bridges problem and critical criminology, which I've taught for many years. But it's obvious that we'll try to use law. What other solution would you have for women who have migrated from a society where they felt oppressed by their religion to a Western society where they suddenly see Sharia in an oppressive way, the way victims of torture see policemen in uniform? I mean, it's almost like, how do we deal with that without the law? What alternative would you present in a social contract pluralistic diverse society?
So I think on the first, you're absolutely right, that this pattern of appeal to legality as a mechanism for hiding the messiness of a variety of different problems is a pattern. It's a feature of the mode of appeal to law that we're describing. It's not specific, I don't think, to secularism and religion. I actually think one area where it comes up a lot is in mental health. And so in criminal law, we're really deeply interested in making sure that someone is either guilty or not guilty. And that other status of maybe not quite responsible because of other complicating factors is one that we're really uncomfortable allowing to become too big. So I think it is a feature. I think you're right in saying this can happen with class, it can happen with gender, it can happen with race, it can happen with religion. What other features or what other possibilities are there? Well, I think there's a number that we want to experiment with. I feel pretty comfortable saying over-reliance, right? Law being too central to the project of defining this has pathologies that I'm uncomfortable with. So of course law will be a part of the picture of holding community together. And you can have more or less monistic, more or less critical engagements with that. But there are a lot of other possibilities. There are a lot of other mechanisms and institutional places that present opportunities for crafting community. Deliberative institutions, we could think instead of legality in terms of participation. We could talk about investment in community. There are a number of other ways we could think about what primarily is going to get us thinking about these kinds of lines of belonging, where law doesn't have to occupy the dominant, the trunk of the debate. And that's my real interest.
My question really picks up, I think, very closely on your last answer. I wonder whether there are conceptions of community that you would accept where law would be reasonably central to the definition. It seems to me that you're rejecting an emphasis on the unity of